Our gracious Heavenly Father, we would like to praise and thank you for your bountiful blessings and ask for the special blessing of your presence this morning. We pray that you will speak to our hearts and minds, give us clarity of thought and receptiveness, and we pray for a rich measure of your Spirit to imbue us today. And we thank you for hearing us, and we pray that your servant will be hidden in Christ, and that his lips will speak your words to us today and feed our souls. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Our topic this morning is called the Omega. You may realize already the Omega. Omega is the last letter of the Greek alphabet. And to start out with, we need to lay some groundwork and understand some foundational principles of Christianity and of Adventism. When we go back to the very beginning, at creation we read, God said, "Let us make man in our image after our likeness." So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him, male and female created he them. Mankind was made in the image of God, revealing to us that God has an image himself, that God has a personal shape and form. S. N. Haskell, one of the early pioneers, one of the ministers of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, wrote in the Review and Herald, at the very time that this question was being agitated, he wrote, "Of late the question has repeatedly come to me, does it make any real difference whether we believe in the personality of God as long as we believe in God? My answer invariably is, it depends." Now that doesn't sound like a very good answer.
Good answer
right from the start. But let's bear with him. He says, "It depends altogether upon the standpoint from which we view it. If from the spiritualists, the Christian scientists, the universalists, or from the standpoint of any other ist or ism, it makes but little or no difference. But the standpoint of Seventh-day Adventists, it makes all the difference in the world."
Amen.
Makes all the difference in the world. "No man who is a Seventh-day Adventist can understandingly take that position. Neither can a Seventh-day Adventist hold that position for a moment. But unfortunately, Seventh-day Adventism has adopted that very position today." "Neither can a Seventh-day Adventist hold that position for a moment. It is involved a denial of the Father and the Son, the law of Moses, the prophets, the Psalms, the holy angels, the personality of the devil, and all that is according to sound doctrine." So he recognized that all of Christianity, every doctrine, hinges upon that point of the personality of God. Hebrews 11:6, it says, "But without faith it is impossible to please him, for he that cometh to God must believe that he is." And I'll pause there for a moment. To believe that he is. It's hard to believe that he is when we believe that he's scattered in a billion parts all over the universe. And I'll leave that with you to think about for a moment. In John 17:21, we read that they all may be one as thou, Father, art in me and I in thee, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me. And the glory which thou gavest me I have given them, that they may be one even as we are one. Some have struggled with the concept, having accepted the Trinity. They try to explain it. Well, how is God one? How is Jesus and the Father one? And they confuse the identity of the Father and the Son, and they include the Holy Spirit. And they come up with various theories, but Jesus tells us here that he's not talking numerically when he says one. One can have a definition that refers to numerics. It refers to a single entity. But it also can mean united. When we speak of being one in spirit, one in heart, we're talking about a unity. And this is the definition that Jesus uses when he's talking about himself and his Father. They are united, but not one individual being. And he says here that they, that is the disciples, you and I, may be one as thou, Father, art in me and I in thee. So he's telling us that in the same way that we can be one, he and his Father are one. And when we become one, we don't become one individual. We don't lose our identity. And neither does he and his Father lose their identity in being one. It's a unity of thought, of mind, of heart. Yes, brother.
I was going to say in spirit.
In spirit.
Not in form that we are recognized.
That's right. In Genesis 5:24, we read that Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God took him. Enoch knew a personal God. Noah was a just man and perfect in his generations, and Noah walked with God. This is not saying that they were literally walking together, but in another sense, it was literal, because everywhere Enoch went, everything that he did, he included God. He recognized God as a personal being, speaking with him, communicating with him, listening to him, and involving him. Exodus 33:21-22, we read, "And the Lord said, Behold, there is a place by me, and thou shalt stand upon a rock, and it shall come to pass, while my glory passeth by, that I will put thee in a cleft of the rock, and I will cover thee with my hand while I pass by, and I will take away mine hand, and thou shalt see my back parts, but my face shall not be seen." So it's clear from this scripture that the being that is speaking to Moses is a real, tangible being, has a shape and a form. He tells him, I'm going to put my hand over you. I'm going to pass by, and you will see my back parts, but not my face. He's a real, literal being with a shape and a form. We read in Exodus 24:10, "And they saw the God of Israel, and there was under his feet, as it were, a paved work of sapphire stone, and as it were, the body of heaven in his clearness." So God has feet. "Who being the brightness of his glory," we read in Hebrews 1:3, "and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God." In the first text, we read that Jesus is in the express image of his Father. If that's the case, his Father must have a form, must have an image. In the next text, we read that Jesus is in the very form of God. So God must have a form. This is scriptural. This is basic to Christianity. "I beheld till the thrones were cast down, and the Ancient of Days did sit," and it describes his shape, his form, his being. It says, "whose garment was white as snow, and the hair of his head like the pure wool." So he has hair. "His throne was like fiery flame, and his wheels as burning fire." So it describes his head, his hair, that he's sitting on a throne. This is not a Buddhist god that's just sitting on a cloud somewhere, formed of vapor. "And let them make me a sanctuary that I may dwell among them," Exodus 25:8. God was impressing upon the people that he had a real dwelling place. The sanctuary was built after the pattern of the true sanctuary in heaven. Now there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan came also among them. Job 1:6. The Lord is in his holy temple. The Lord's throne is in heaven. His eyes behold, his eyelids try the children of men. Describes his eyes, his eyelids, him sitting. It describes the place of his dwelling in the temple. God doesn't just dwell everywhere. Contrary to public opinion. We're going to talk a little bit more about how he dwells everywhere. But we read here in Isaiah 6, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord sitting upon a throne. Well, Isaiah saw the Lord. He's sitting upon a throne. And his train filled the temple. Above it stood the seraphims. Each one had six wings. With twain he covered his face, with twain he covered his feet, and with twain he did fly. And one cried to another and said, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. And the posts of the door moved at the voice of him that cried, and the house was filled with smoke. So, a description of a very real, tangible being, a person with a form and a shape. Now, obviously, flesh and blood doth not inherit the kingdom of heaven. It's obviously not necessarily the same type of material. But nevertheless, it is a body and a form. Yes.
Also in the house.
And a house.
Yes. An abode.
Now, it may not be with stones and with lumber, but nevertheless, in whatever they build with, there is a place, a dwelling place. Then said I, Woe is me, for I am undone, because I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. For mine eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. So this is not like a prophetic vision. He's seeing a dragon in heaven or whatever. This is a real scene that he's seeing. And it changes his religion. We read in the spirit of prophecy how it changed his whole religion, because he had a sort of a pride and an attitude that was changed at this point. Now he recognized himself as a sinner. It humbled him. We read in Scripture countless times when people saw angels, they fell at the feet of the angel and woe is me, you know, they recognized their frailty, their weakness, and their uncleanness. In Revelation 4:2, we read, And immediately I was in the Spirit, and behold, a throne was set in heaven, and one sat on the throne. And I saw in the right hand of him that sat on the throne a book written within and on the backside sealed with seven seals. So from beginning of Scripture to the end, to the last book, we find the same testimony. God is depicted as a real being that has a body and a form. In early writings, Ellen White speaks of spiritualism. She says, I have frequently been falsely charged with teaching views peculiar to spiritualism. But before the editor of the Day Star ran into that delusion, the Lord gave me a view of the sad and desolating effects that would be produced upon the flock by him and others in teaching the spiritual views. Now, these spiritual views are not spiritual in a good sense. She's using it as describing spiritualism. Okay, so I have often seen the lovely Jesus that he is a person. And notice how she uses the word person. Person means to have a body and a form. She says, I asked him if his father was a person and had a form like himself. Said Jesus, I am in the express image of my father's person. Clear statement, Jesus and the Father have a body, a person, a form. And to not believe that is what is it called?
Spiritualism.
Spiritualism. I've often seen that the spiritual, once again, not in a good sense, in other words, spiritualistic, I've often seen that the spiritual view took away all the glory of heaven, and that in many minds the throne of David and the lovely person of Jesus have been burned up in the fire of spiritualism. Now stop and think for a moment. The spiritual view, spiritualistic view, took away all the glory of heaven. If God dwells everywhere, just as an essence, he has no specific dwelling place. I once heard a radio broadcast that started out by the pastor interviewing a small child. And the small child asked the minister a question, "Where is heaven?" When the minister said that God was everywhere, the child said something to the effect that, "Well, heaven must be everywhere." And so if you make God simply an essence that's everywhere, that's in reality what you do. You destroy the dwelling place of God. You destroy heaven. And so this has a lot of ramifications. We're going to see a lot more in a moment. But I've seen that some who have been deceived and led into this error will be brought out into the light of truth, but it will be almost impossible for them to get entirely rid of the deceptive power of spiritualism. Such should make thorough work in confessing their errors and leaving them forever. So once you get involved in this spiritualism, it's hard to get out. And it's hard to ever be straight again. This is what is referred to as spiritualism. "I saw a throne, and on it sat the Father and the Son. I gazed on Jesus' countenance and admired his lovely person. The Father's person I cannot behold." Now, once again, she's using the word person to mean what? Something that can be seen, a physical form. "I gazed on Jesus' countenance and admired his lovely person. The Father's person I cannot behold, for a cloud of glorious light covered him. I asked Jesus if his Father had a form like himself. He said he had, but I could not behold it. For, said he, if you should once behold the glory of his person, you would cease to exist." So, we can't behold it, but he has a form. James White, he has a way of writing that's very pointed and straight. And notice what he says here. "We here add the testimony of Christ, and the Father himself, which hath sent me, hath borne witness of me. You've neither heard his voice at any time nor seen his shape." See also Philippians 2:6. To say that the Father has not a personal shape seems the most pointed contradiction of plain scripture terms. He goes on to say, he lists an objection and an answer. "God is a spirit," John 4:24. This is the objection. Answer, "Angels are also spirits," Psalms 104, verse 4. "Yet those that visited Abraham and Lot lay down, ate, and took hold of Lot's hand. They were spirit beings. So is God a spirit being." Objection, "God is everywhere." Proof, 139 verses 1 to 8. "He is as much in every place as in any one place." That's the objection. Okay, God is everywhere. So how can he have a personal shape and a form? Answer, "God is everywhere by virtue of his omniscience, as will be seen by the very words of David referred to above. Verses 1 to 6. O Lord, thou hast searched me and known me. Thou knowest my downsitting and mine uprising. Thou understandest my thought afar off." God doesn't become a microbe and enter into the brain of an individual to dwell inside him. He doesn't have to be scattered in a billion parts all over the universe to be present everywhere. It's by his omniscience, knowing what's going on. He can see what's going on. He can hear what's going on. He can act He can speak the word and it will come into existence. So it's like he's everywhere, but it's not in a physical way. He's not just an essence. He has a personal shape and a form. Thou compassest my path and my lying down, and art acquainted with all my ways. For there is not a word in my tongue, but lo, O Lord, thou knowest it altogether. Thou hast beset me behind and before, and laid thy hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high, I cannot attain it. So God is everywhere by virtue of his omniscience. Secondly, God is everywhere by virtue of his Spirit, which is his representative and is manifested wherever he pleases, as will be seen by the very words the objector claims, referred to above, verses 7 to 10. Whither shall I go from thy Spirit, or whither shall I flee from thy presence? If I ascend up into heaven, thou art there. If I make my bed in hell, behold, thou art there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there shall thy hand lead me, and thy right hand shall hold me. So it's by his Spirit that he is everywhere. He goes on to say, God is in heaven. This we are taught in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father which art in heaven. Matthew 6, 9 and Luke 11, 2. But if God is as much in every place as he is in any one place, then heaven is also as much in every place as it is in any one place. And the idea of going to heaven is all a mistake. We are all in heaven, and the Lord's Prayer, according to this foggy theology, simply means, Our Father which art everywhere, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is everywhere. Jesus is said to be on the right hand of the Majesty on high. So then after the Lord had spoken unto them, he was received up into heaven and sat on the right hand of God. Hebrews 1:3. Mark 16:19. But if heaven be everywhere and God everywhere, then Christ's ascension up to heaven at the Father's right hand simply means that he went everywhere. He was only taken up where the cloud hid him from the gaze of his disciples and then evaporated and went everywhere. So that instead of the lovely Jesus so beautifully described in both Testaments, we have only a sort of essence dispersed throughout the entire universe, And in harmony with this rarefied theology, Christ's second advent or his return would be the condensation of this essence to some locality. Say the Mount of Olivet. Christ arose from the dead with a physical form. He is not here, said the angel, for he is risen, as he said. Matthew 28:6. Like I say, James White had a very straight pointed way of writing and speaking. O sectarianism, O atheism, O annihilation, who can perceive the nice shades of difference between the one and the other? They seem all alike. What is he talking about when he says sectarianism? Methodists, Baptists, the different sects, the different denominations, we would say today. He's saying that there's no difference between the various denominations and the atheist. And annihilation, in other words, nothingness. They seem all alike, or they seem alike, all but in name. The atheist has no God. The sectarian has a God without body or parts. Who can define the difference? For our part, we do not perceive a difference of a single hair. They both claim to be the negative of all things which exist, and both are equally powerless and unknown. The atheist has no afterlife or conscious existence beyond the grave. The sectarian has one, but it is immaterial, like his God, and without body or parts. Here again, both are negative and both arrive at the same point. Their faith and hope amount to the same, only it is expressed by different terms. Do you see how this idea destroys the whole Christian economy? (Clears throat) Does not God say he fills immensity of space? This is in an article called The Sabbath God, interestingly. And the other one's called The Sunday God. Does not God say he fills immensity of space? We answer, no. Psalms 139, 7 and 8. Whither shall I go from thy spirit? Or whither shall I flee from thy presence? If I ascend up into heaven, thou art there, etc. God by his spirit may fill heaven and earth, etc. Some confound God with his spirit. Okay, I want you to think for a moment. When we talk about my spirit, is it a person? Yes. But is that all there is to me? My spirit is a part of me, but it's not all there is of me. So we need to keep the distinction clear between God and his spirit. Is the spirit Jesus? Yes. But is that all there is of Jesus? No. Some confound God with his spirit, which makes confusion. Psalms 104, verse 4. 111, verse 4, sorry. The Lord is in his holy temple. The Lord's throne is in heaven. His eyes behold, etc. Habakkuk 2:20 and Psalms 102, verse 19. For he hath looked down from the height of his sanctuary. From heaven did the Lord behold the earth. So it describes him being omniscient. It describes him seeing and knowing all things, but not scattered in a billion parts as an essence. In the article called The Sunday God, he says, we will make a few extracts that the reader may see the broad contrast between the God of the Bible brought to light through Sabbath keeping and the God in the dark through Sunday keeping. Catholic Catechism, now he quotes from there. Question, where is God? Answer, God is everywhere. Question, does God see and know all things? Answer, yes, he does know and see all things. Question, has God any body? No, God has no body. He is a pure spirit. This is Catholic doctrine, straight from the mouth of the Catholics, that God has no body. He is pure spirit. It has no place in Adventism. It has no place among believers. Amen. Question, are there more gods than one? No, there is but one God. Are there more persons than one in God? Yes, in God there are three persons. Question, which are they? God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Ghost. Question, are there not three gods? Answer, no, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost are all but one and the same God. Confusion. Question. He's still quoting from the Catechism. Has God any body? No. God has no body. He is pure spirit. Question. Are there more gods than one? No, there is but one God. Are there more persons than one in God? Yes, in God there are three persons, etc. The first article of the Methodist religion, page 8, there is but one living and true God, everlasting, without body or parts, of infinite power, wisdom, and goodness, the maker and the preserver of all things, visible and invisible. And in unity of this Godhead, there are three persons of one substance, power and eternity, the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. So this is Methodist belief, as well as Catholic belief. In this article, like the Catholic doctrine, we are taught that there are three persons of one substance, power, and eternity, making in all one living and true God, everlasting, without body or parts. But in all this, we are not told of what became of the body of Jesus, who had a body when he ascended, who went to God, who is everywhere or nowhere. Doxology, to God the Father, God the Son, God the Spirit, three in one. Ministry of healing. Ellen White says, the Bible shows us God in his high and holy place, not in a state of inactivity, not in silence and solitude, but surrounded by 10,000 times 10,000 and thousands of thousands of holy beings all waiting to do his will. Through these messengers, living beings, Through these messengers, he is in active communication with every part of his dominion. By his Spirit, he is everywhere present. Through the agency of his Spirit and his angels, he ministers to the children of men. And we're going to see in a moment just a little more about this. The greatness of God to us is incomprehensible. The Lord's throne is in heaven. Yet by his Spirit, he is everywhere present. By his Spirit, he is everywhere present. He has an intimate knowledge of and a personal interest in all the works of his hand. Who is likened to the Lord our God who dwelleth on high, who humbleth himself to behold the things that are in heaven and in the earth? This is from the book Education. We don't find in Adventism the idea that God is simply omnipresent, full stop. We don't find that concept. It's always with the idea that God is everywhere present by his Spirit. Uriah Smith, article on the omnipresence of God, says here and hereafter, he says, again it is urged that God is omnipresent. And how can this be if he is a person? Answer, he has a representative, his Holy Spirit, by which he is ever present and ever felt in all the universe, all his universe. Whither shall I go, asks David, from thy Spirit, or whither shall I flee from thy presence? Psalms 139, verse 7, and John saw standing before the throne of God seven lamps, which are declared to be the seven spirits of God, which are sent forth into all the earth. So it's by his Spirit that he is everywhere present. This was the collective view, the unanimous view, in fact, for the first 50 years in Adventism. We now invite the attention of the reader to a little of the evidence that may be presented to show that God is a person, and so that man, though of course in an imperfect and finite degree, may be an image or likeness of him as to his bodily form. Loughborough says, but his Spirit has been on the earth, the comforter that he promised to send. So in the same manner, God manifests himself by his, what? Spirit, which is also the power through which he works. But if the Spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his Spirit that dwelleth in you. Here is a plain distinction made between the Spirit and God that raises the dead by that Spirit. I often hear us in this movement saying, Jesus is the Holy Spirit, and I don't have a problem with that. But we need to maintain the clear distinction between the Spirit and Jesus, the Spirit and God. We need to realize that the Spirit is not all that there is of Jesus. It's not all that there is of God. If the living God is a Spirit, in the strictest sense of the term, and at the same time is in possession of a Spirit, then we have at once the novel idea of the Spirit of a Spirit. Something it will take at least a spiritualist to explain. An Adventist minister, having graduated from theology and pastored for 30 years, told me he was taught in the seminary that the Holy Spirit had a spirit. Mercy. And the Father had a spirit. And Jesus had a spirit.
Not one spirit.
In the 1872 Fundamental Beliefs of Seventh-day Adventists, it says that there is one God, a personal spiritual being, the creator of all things, omnipotent, omniscient, and eternal, infinite in wisdom, holiness, justice, goodness, truth, and mercy, unchangeable, and is what? Everywhere present by his representative, the Holy Spirit. So this is how Adventism has taught. This was foundational Adventism, that God is present everywhere by the Holy Spirit. That was changed in 1980 to read, there is one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, a unity of three co-eternal persons. God is immortal, all-powerful, all-knowing, above all, and ever-present, period. Full stop. That's the problem. He is infinite and beyond human comprehension, yet known through his self-revelation. He is forever worthy of worship, adoration, and service by the whole creation. This is in Seventh-day Adventist Belief, page 16. It goes on to say, God is omnipresent, transcending all space, yet he is fully present in every part of space. That has done the exact thing that Ellen White said it does. It destroys God. It makes him nothing but an essence. He's eternal, exceeding the limits of time, yet is fully present in every moment of time. This is spiritualism. Haskell, he continued in the article, the same article I was reading earlier, he says, therefore, we repeat what we previously said, to deny the personality of God is to deny the existence of the sanctuary in the heavens, for there God dwells. Do you see why they're denying the sanctuary today? If you deny that God has a personal shape and a form, then he doesn't need a dwelling place. So out goes the temple, the sanctuary. It is to deny the existence of angels, for they are his throne. It is to deny the law of God, for it is the foundation of his throne. It is to deny the existence of Satan, for he is a fallen angel. It makes the light and life which God created and which proceeds from him, whether it be in the grass, or in cats or dogs, or in mankind, to be the God. Do you follow? Since man, however, is the highest form of light and life, he necessarily becomes the supreme deity. It leads men to worship the creature more than the creator. What is this called? Pantheism.
It was Kellogg, right?
Pantheism. Kellogg. We lift a warning voice against any such doctrine from whatever source it comes. We say the Bible and the Bible only shall be our creed. In it is salvation. Do you need to look at that again? It makes the light and life which God created and which proceeds from him, his spirit, whether it be in the grass or in cats or dogs or in mankind, to be the God. Since man, however, is the highest form of light and life, he necessarily becomes the supreme deity. Some of these things are deep. And so we need to stop and just meditate on some of these things until we grasp the thought. But there's a lot of meat there. Ellen White said in the New York Indicator, February 7 of 1906, he who denies the personality of God and of his Son Jesus Christ is denying God in Christ. Okay, so to deny the personality, in other words, that they have a body and a form, is to deny them. If that which ye have heard from the beginning shall remain in you, ye also shall continue in the Son and in the Father. If you continue to believe and obey the truths you first embraced regarding the personality of the Father and the Son, you will be joined together with him in love. There will be seen that union for which Christ prayed just before his trial and crucifixion. In the spirit of prophecy, a number of times, numerous times, she refers to this term, office of the Holy Spirit. We're going to look at a few examples. Whom Christ pardons, he first makes penitent, and it is the office of the Holy Spirit to convince of sin. And again, the incarnation of Christ, his divinity, his atonement. Who is this talking about? Christ, right? The incarnation of Christ, his, that is Christ's divinity, his atonement, that is Christ's atonement, His, that is Christ's wonderful life in heaven as our advocate, the office of the Holy Spirit, that's again talking about Christ. The office of the Holy Spirit, we're going to see that in a moment. All these living, vital themes of Christianity are revealed from Genesis to Revelation. The office of the Holy Spirit is distinctly specified in the words of Christ. When He has come, He will reprove the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. And again, it is the office of the Holy Spirit to bring to mind in clear, distinct lines the words and works of Christ, that those who teach concerning the Redeemer of the world may have power to lift up Christ before the minds of their classes. Once again, she's talking about Christ when she's talking about the office of the Holy Spirit. This is a subject that appears countless times in the writings of Ellen White, the office of the Holy Spirit. It is the office of the Holy Spirit to reveal to the mind the character of the consecration that God will accept. Through the agency of the Holy Spirit, the soul is enlightened and the character is renewed, sanctified, and uplifted. Let's take a look at the meaning of office, the definition of office. First of all, from the Noah Webster 1828 dictionary, it tells us a particular duty, charge, or trust conferred by public authority and for a public purpose, an employment undertaken by commission or authority from government or those who administer it. Thus we speak of the office of Secretary of State, office of treasurer, office of a judge, of a sheriff, of a justice, of peace. Officers are civil, judicial, ministerial, executive, legislative, political, municipal, diplomatic, military, ecclesiastical, etc. I have a lot of definitions here. I want you to be certain about the meaning of office. The second definition there in the same dictionary, a duty, charge, or trust of a sacred nature, conferred by God Himself as the office of a priest in the Old Testament and that of the apostles in the New Testament. Definition number five, business, particular employment, Hesperus, whose office is to bring twilight upon the earth. The Apostle Paul uses it in this sense, in so much as I am the apostle of the Gentiles, I magnify my office. Okay, the office of apostleship. A position of trust, a responsibility or duty, especially in government or organization, the office of president. Duty or function, the office of an administrator. This is from Collins Dictionary now. Webster's New World College Dictionary now. Something performed or intended to be performed for another. Some service done through someone's good or ill offices. Number two, function or duty assigned to someone, especially as an essential part of his or her work or position. So it's a duty, it's a trust. Authority, a position of authority or trust, especially in government, business, institution. The office of president. Any of the branches of the U.S. government, ranking next below the departments, a governmental department, the Foreign Office, a religious service or set of prayers, divine office. Now, so an office is when we talk about the office, for example, of foreign affairs or the office of the president, it's not that office would not exist, the office of the president would not exist if it were not for who? The president. It's all about the president. But yet there are office staff. And those staff are right, you know, you might receive a letter from the office of the president. Someone has done some research for him, someone has written it out, someone else has typed it, someone has sent it in the mail, but the president looks over and says, yeah, that's what I want to say. Send that. President says, put together a letter on this topic or answer it in this way, and someone does it. There are assistants. There's an office staff. In 1 Samuel 10:6, we read, "The Spirit of the Lord will come upon thee, and thou shalt prophesy with them, and shalt be turned into another man." Who is this talking about?
Saul.
And he says that when the Spirit of the Lord comes upon you and you're going to prophesy, you're going to be turned into another man. So it speaks about another office as if it's another person. Saul held the office of king. Now he was going to hold the office of prophet for a short time. But nevertheless, office of a prophet. David held the office of a prophet throughout his life. He wrote the Psalms. And so when we talk about office, it's in a sense person as well. And that's what we're going to see in a moment. But first of all, look at this statement here that talks about the third person. This is the famous statement on the third person from Desire of Ages 671. And it starts out with talking about the office work of the Holy Spirit. That's the context. In describing to his disciples the office work of the Holy Spirit, Jesus sought to inspire them with the joy and hope that inspired his own heart. Sin, etc. Sin could be resisted and overcome only through the mighty agency of the third person of the Godhead. Through the Spirit, the believer becomes a partaker of the divine nature. Christ has given his Spirit as a divine power to overcome all hereditary and cultivated tendencies to evil and to impress his own character upon his church. So notice that the context of this statement is office work. Let's look up the word person now. We looked up the word office in the dictionary. Let's look up the word person. What does it say? Number 6, definition number 6 in Noah Webster 1828 dictionary. Person has the meaning character of office. The example given to us is, how different is the same man from himself as he sustains the person of a magistrate and that of a friend. In other words, the office of a magistrate and that of a friend. There's two different works, two different functions, two different duties, two different offices. And that's a meaning of person. So when Ellen White When Ellen White uses the word person in the context of office work, she is referring to the third office. She's saying this is an office of Jesus. He functions as a mediator in heaven, in the sanctuary in heaven. And he functions as a spirit on earth. And so this is an office of Christ. And that's the context of person here. You know, when we read and study, we need to look at the context and understand what the author is trying to say. And we've seen that I could quote 30 different places or more where Ellen White uses that subject of office work of the Holy Spirit. It was a predominant theme when she's talking about the Holy Spirit. And in this context where she talks about the third person of the Godhead, she's talking about office work. That's clear from the context. Notice this statement in comparison with another one in the same book. Sin could be resisted and overcome only through the mighty agency of the third person of the Godhead. Here on page 324, it tells us the only defense against evil. Okay, it's using the same terminology. The only defense against evil, now we have a different word here, but it's the same thought, is the indwelling of Christ in the heart through faith in his righteousness. Well, sin and evil are synonymous. And both are saying that there's only one way. This one says that it's only by the third person. Here it says it's only by the indwelling of Christ. That third person has to be Christ. Otherwise, she's speaking out of two sides of her mouth, saying the opposite. But it's the same author. It's the same book. She's telling us that the third person is another office of this same being. It's Christ. When Christ dwells in the heart, it's the office of the Holy Spirit. Does the Bible agree? Yes. 1 John 3:6 tells us, whosoever abideth in him, not some other being, but whosoever abideth in Christ, sinneth not. This told us that there's only one way to overcome sin, and that is by the third person of the Godhead. And here, there's only one way to overcome, and that is by the indwelling of Christ. Here it tells us by the indwelling of Christ, or by us dwelling in Him. That's the only way to overcome sin. It's all in agreement. Now, while Christ is a minister in the sanctuary above, He is also, through His delegates, the minister of His church on earth. Who are these delegates? While Jesus ministers in the sanctuary above, He is still, by His Spirit, the minister of the church on earth. He is withdrawn from the eye of sins, but His parting promise is fulfilled, "Lo, I'm with you always." So here we find that by His Spirit, He's the minister of the church on earth. Here it says through His what?
Delegates.
Through His delegates. Okay, we talked about office staff. So when we talk about Spirit, we may not only be talking about Christ, we may be talking also about His office staff.
Yes.
Just as if you received, probably the sister that was here that mentioned she received a letter from the Pope, it was probably from his office, the Pope's office, which included some staff members, I would assume. Because I don't think the Pope sits down and writes and types out and puts in the mail every single letter to every individual he sends a letter to. He probably has some help. But here in Acts of the Apostles, we read, "By night the angel of the Lord opened the prison doors and said to the disciples, 'Go stand and speak in the temple to the people all the words of this life.'" So here we read that the angel is speaking to the disciples, "Go stand and speak in the temple." Is that clear? Says angel, right? I want you to notice that word. Here it says the command given by the Holy Spirit, "Go stand and speak in the temple." Well, is she contradicting herself? Here she says that the command was by the Holy Spirit. Here she says the command is by an angel. Is that a contradiction? No, because the angels are part of the office staff. That's how Christ communicates. The command given by the Holy Spirit, "Go stand and speak in the temple to the people all the words of this life," was obeyed by the apostles. They entered into the temple early in the morning and taught. Now, here we see the office staff is enlarged a little more. The heavenly angels are waiting to unite with the human agent, that many souls may hear and be impressed by the Holy Spirit. So how does the Holy Spirit come upon someone? How does it impress someone?
Through the
angels and the human agent. That doesn't make us the Holy Spirit, but we can be part of the office staff. And in fact, we better be. Christ, our mediator, is the one who gives the Holy Spirit. Okay, that clearly identifies the source. A measure of the Spirit is given to every man to profit withal. Through the ministry of the angels, the Holy Spirit is enabled to work upon the mind and heart of the human agent. Through the agency of the Holy Spirit, man becomes the agent through which souls are brought into the kingdom of heaven. I've often been misunderstood and misquoted and misstated in this topic. But I hope that this can clarify some things for some of you. The Church of Christ, every individual disciple of the Master, is heaven's appointed channel for the revelation of God to men. Angels of glory wait to communicate through you heaven's light and power to souls that are ready to perish. Shall the human agent fail of accomplishing his appointed work? Oh, then to that degree is the world robbed of the promised influence of the Holy Spirit. If we fail to do our work, if we fail to be channels, the world is robbed of a degree of the Holy Spirit's influence. That's pretty heavy. It lays a solemn responsibility upon us to fulfill our work in being channels. This brings us to Butler. And we'll wrap it up shortly. This is a letter from Kellogg to G.I. Butler, 1903. As far as I can fathom the difficulty which is found in the living temple, the whole thing may be simmered down to the question, is the Holy Ghost a person? You say no. I had supposed the Bible said this for the reason that the personal pronoun he is used in speaking of the Holy Ghost. Sister White uses the pronoun he and has said in so many words that the Holy Ghost is what? The third person of the Godhead. How the Holy Ghost can be a third person and not be a person at all is difficult for me to see. That is the very statement that Kellogg tripped up on. He didn't understand that third person was referring to the office of the Holy Spirit. He thought this is saying that it's another being. So that's why we have gone to the foundation. We've gone to the causative factors that brought about the Alpha, which we've got to understand if we're going to understand the Omega. Finally, my son said to me, Mother, you ought to read at least some parts of the book talking about Living Temple by Kellogg, that you may see whether they are in harmony with the light that God has given you. For those of you that don't know, Dr. Kellogg was a medical doctor leading out in the Adventist medical work at the turn of the century, from the 1800s to the 1900s. And he wrote a book, and this was published in 1903. It was called Living Temple, in which he explained some ideas that had been formulating in his mind since 1896-7, first presented in 1897 at the General Conference. But he said, but Willie White, anyway, speaks to his mother, says, finally my son said to me, Mother, you ought to read at least some parts of the book, that you may see whether they are in harmony with the light that God has given you. He sat down beside me, and together we read the preface, and most of the first chapter, and also paragraphs in other chapters. As we read, I recognized the very sentiments against which I had been bidden to speak in warning during the early days of my public labors. When I first left the state of Maine, it was to go through Vermont and Massachusetts to bear testimony against these sentiments. Living Temple contains the Alpha of these theories. I knew that the Omega would follow in a little while, and I trembled for our people. I knew that I must warn our brethren and sisters, not to enter into controversy over the presence and personality of God. The statements made in Living Temple in regard to this point are incorrect. The scripture used to substantiate the doctrine there set forth is scripture misapplied. So what is the Alpha about? The personality and the presence of God. Few can, and this is where Selected Messages, Book 1, page 203. And this is where she introduces this concept of Omega. Now, when we talk about ABCs, we say, oh, he knows the ABCs. Do we stop at C? Does that mean somebody knows A, B, and C, and that's all the letters they know? No. ABCs means the whole alphabet. When we talk about Alpha and Omega, we're talking about the whole thing. Alpha, Beta, Gamma, Delta, Epsilon. We're talking about the whole Greek alphabet, beginning to end. Few can discern the result of entertaining the sophistries advocated by some at this time, but the Lord has lifted the curtain and has shown me the result that would follow. The spiritualistic theories regarding the personality of God. Now, what did we see were the spiritualistic theories? That God has no what? No form. No body. The spiritualistic theories regarding the personality of God follow to their logical conclusion, sweep away the whole Christian economy. And let me back up for a moment. She points out here that it's the presence and personality of God. As we were talking about, that God is everywhere present by the Holy Spirit, by His Spirit. Okay, not physically. And He's not just an essence scattered around. Okay, so when we're talking about personality, we're talking about presence as well. Because one hinges on the other. It sweeps away the whole Christian economy when we hold these spiritualistic views. We saw that a few moments ago. They estimate as nothing the light that Christ came from heaven to give John to give to his people. Remember what S. N. Haskell said. They teach that the scenes just before us are not of sufficient importance to be given special attention. They make of no effect the truth of heavenly origin and rob the people of God of their past experience, giving them instead a false science. The difficulties that have arisen have been very hard to meet, and they are far from being settled yet. One and another, still another, are presented to me as having been led to accept the pleasing fables that mean the sanctification of sin. The living temple contains the alpha of what? A train of heresies. In other words, there's not just two heresies. We're not talking about one heresy called the Alpha and another one called the Omega. That's not the way it is. There's a train of heresies. When she says the Omega is coming, that means you're going through Alpha, Beta, Gamma, Delta all the way. So it means full apostasy. Entire apostasy. It means total abomination. These heresies are similar to those that I met in my first labors. We read that at the very beginning from early writings. I bore them a message similar to the message I have been bearing for the last 2 months. I was instructed that the ideas that they had accepted were but the alpha of a great deception. I had to meet similar delusions in Portsmouth and in Boston. And the reason why it's such a great delusion is because it's the wrong understanding of the personality of God sweeps away the whole Christian economy. Now, this is just a sketch and needs a lot of improvement, but the personality of God lies at the foundation of the whole system of truth. It lies at the foundation of the Christian economy. Upon this point hinges everything. If you deny the personality of God, you will accept the Trinity. You will destroy the personality of Christ and of angels. You will destroy the doctrine of the heavenly sanctuary. And when that's gone, you destroy the mediation of Christ, the priestly ministry of Christ, and it goes on and on and on. Everything will crumble. When you remove the foundation of the building, every other teaching and doctrine falls. And in like manner, when you lay the wrong foundation, you take away the personality of God, say that God has no body and form, that He's omnipresent, full stop, without the Holy Spirit, everything else crumbles. And this system, because you take away the priest, You put Christ in his, you, because you take away Christ, you put the priest, you put a man in his place. When you take away the temple in heaven, the sanctuary in heaven, you put an earthly temple in its place. When you take away the mediation of Christ, you put saints in the place. Mary and Peter and whatever. And it just goes on and on and on. It builds a whole system of righteousness by works with man at the center and everything focused on man. Brothers and sisters, that's it. But that, we don't have time to cover all of the train of heresies that have come in, bringing us all the way to the Omega. That will be another time. But it has already happened. We have already seen from the introduction of the Trinity in 1927 with the printing of the book Coming Comforter by Froome, to the change of the baptismal vows and the rewriting of the books and the evangelical conferences and the changing of our history books, the writing of questions on doctrine and on and on and on until we have. Now we don't believe in the sanctuary, we throw that out, we throw out the overcoming sin, we change the nature of sin and the nature of Christ, and just on and on and on. So, shall we pray? Our Father in heaven, we have considered some things today about the very nature of the God that we serve, about the very fundamental things of Christianity. And I pray that these deep things can be in our hearts and minds as we go about our business today. I pray that you will help us to comprehend them, help us as we mull over these things to see the significance and importance and make it clear in our minds. And I pray that you will establish truth in us, sanctify us through thy truth. Thy word is truth. And I pray that you will draw near to us through the remaining hours of this camp meeting. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.